So I would like to give you an overview over the application of code coupling in magnetic fusion. And this has been work that has been performed within collaboration of the Max Planck Institute for Plasma Physics with the Technical University of Munich, where I bring in expertise from the plasma physics side and Ishan Desai and Benjamin Ueckermann expertise from the code coupling side. They have now changed from the Technical University of Munich to the SimTec cluster at the University of Stuttgart. So firstly, I would like to give you a very short introduction into the basics of magnetic confinement fusion. Secondly, I would like to give you examples for multiscale and multiphysics problems within our research field. And finally, I would like to show you the first attempts of a so-called interface coupling, where we try to couple an edge model with a core model. And I would like to especially point out here the geometric challenges at this coupling attempt. So why a fusion of light particles, a large amount of energy is released. So for instance, in the sun, per second, there is 564 million tons of hydrogen is fused to only 560 million tons of helium. So per second, there's a mass difference of 4 million tons that is released in terms of energy. On Earth, of course, we would like to replicate this process in order to build a fusion power plant. And here we rely on the fusion of so-called deuterium and tritium, which are heavy isotopes of hydrogen, to helium and neutron, where also a large amount of energy is released. At such high temperature, however, for sustaining the fusion reactions, very high temperatures of several million degrees of Kelvin are required. And at such high temperatures, the fuel is in a so-called plasma state, which means it consists of an ionized gas made up of positively charged ions and negatively charged electrons. And since the temperatures are so high, it's clear that your fuel can't simply be confined via material walls, but has to be levitated somehow. And we can here exploit the property that our plasma is charged and can use magnetic fields in order to confine the plasma. This is how it looks in a bit more detail. So when you have a magnetic field line, the charged particles of your plasma perform helically orbits around this magnetic field line due to the Lorentz force. And via this, you can the plasma remains kind of attached to the magnetic field and you can levitate your plasma, ideally without any contact to the wall. If you bend the whole plasma now to a ring or to a donut, you end up at the so-called tokamak concept, where the plasma is a donut as indicated here in violet, and the magnetic field lines wind helically around this toroid, torus indicated here with the black line. The magnetic field in a tokamak is created via external coils and via a current that runs inside the plasma itself. Here you can see now a discharge of tokamak in a tokamak reactor of our reactor Aztec upgrade, and you basically see only the outer part or the boundary region of the tokamak glowing here, whereas the actually hot region in the center of the tokamak does not emit light in the visible spectrum. And the size of this reactor is roughly 1.65 meters in major radius and about 50 centimeters in minor radius. And at current day, there are still a lot of open research questions related with the tokamak research. For instance, concerning linear stability of the plasma, the turbulent transport and how we can reduce or suppress the turbulent transport in a plasma, processes happening to plasma wall interaction and heating current drive mechanisms, and also how to set up diagnostics in order to measure the plasma. So now let me give you examples for the multi-scale and multi-physics nature of the magnetic confinement fusion. And what you can see here on the right is a cross-section of the tokamak, where in the very center you have the hot plasma that can be 10 times hotter than the sun in practice, so about 20 kilo electron volts. And as you go further and further out towards the reactor or the chamber walls, you encounter, of course, colder plasma until you encounter basically room temperature at the material wall. So we have temperatures within 50, 60 centimeters, maybe in future reactors 1 or 2 meters, that span from electron volts close to the material walls to several kilo electron volts in the center of the plasma. And I think this makes it clear that we have a multi-scale problem. So because we span here in temperatures, which is a main parameter of our plasma in our model, of several orders of magnitude here. And therefore, a full-scale ab initio modeling is at current state, it's not possible because the models to run such a reactor are just too expensive. Instead, we rely on a hierarchy of models where we have, on the one end, models with a high fidelity that are very accurate, that's like the five-dimensional gyrokinetic description. However, because they are very expensive to run, you can only cover a small fraction or a small window of your tokamak around here. On the other hand, you have systems codes, which often parameterize certain aspects of the plasma or use fits for certain models, with which you can then deal with the whole reactor chamber, but you don't have a model with a very high fidelity, and such models might become questionable, especially when you want to design new reactors. And in between, you have a bunch of other models. Instead of a five-dimensional description, you could reduce to a three-dimensional fluid description, or you could go even down to a transport code where you don't treat the turbulence self-consistently. And the question is now, via coupling techniques, we can achieve a model that can cover the whole tokamak, or it has a high domain coverage, and at the same time has a very high fidelity. However, the situation becomes even worse because we don't only have a multi-scale problem, but we also have a multi-physics problem. So ideally, you have in your tokamak, you just have the fluid in a plasma state consisting of positively charged hydrogen and negatively charged electrons. But in reality, due to sputtering processes at the wall, you also have neutral gas present in your reactor that is not negligible and that interacts with the plasma and obeys different physics model also, of different physics rules here. In addition, you might have also impurities present, like tungsten, like boron, so heavy impurities that you also might want to deal with the different models. And furthermore, you might have radiation, interaction of the plasma wall, and so on and so forth. So you have a lot of different physics processes in your tokamak. So let me come to a kind of straight way how to deal with such a multi-physics issue. And therefore, I would like to take as an example again the coupling of a plasma model with a neutral model here. So imagine you have a plasma model, let's say like a partial differential equation for the plasma density that obeys some complicated partial differential equation here. And you have a neutral model here that where the neutral density, for instance, obeys another complex partial differential equation for the neutrals here. Now both the plasma and the neutrals, of course, interact with each other via, for instance, ionization, recombination, charge exchange, and so on and so forth. So kind of plasma chemistry processes. And you have a source of plasma arising due to the neutrals and vice versa. So, and you couple this at the moment in the most straightforward way. So within each time step, you simply compute the sources for the neutrals and you evolve then the partial differential equation according to the sources. So here you have an example for the coupling of Grillex with a fluid neutral model where you have here the plasma density, you have here the neutral density, and here you have the ionization strength, which is exactly the source neutrals entering the plasma continuity equation here. And in the region where the ionization is strong, you of course have an increased plasma density. Let me note that in reality this is also a very simplified model, because you often have to treat the neutrals kinetically, and therefore there are further code packages, let's say like SOLPS, where the neutrals are modeled via kinetic Monte Carlo code, for instance. Now let me come to the next topic, which is the edge core interface coupling, where I especially want to point out the geometric challenges. So let's first have a geometric view at the edge and the core region here. So when you are in the center of so this is again a cross section of the tokamak. When you are in the center, you have these nicely toroidally nested flux surface indicated here with the symmetric lines. And these symmetric lines are very important for the modeling of the plasma, because the plasma kind of equilibrates along this magnetic flux surface. So ideally, you want to make usage of these flux surface by using flux-aligned coordinates and/or flux-aligned grids here. However, as you go further and further out, you will encounter this black line here. That's a separatrix where you have here a magnetic null in your system. And the problem is, on this magnetic separatrix, your flux-aligned coordinates become singular. So you can't deal with the separatrix with your code at that stage anymore. And as you go further out, you also encounter the open flux surface here that have a contact with the wall. So in the edge region now, which is the region around the separatrix, you have to somehow deal differently. Instead of the flux-aligned coordinates, you have to use, for instance, simply a Cartesian grid, which does not rely on flux surfaces here. And the main question will be, how can you now couple a code that works in these flux-aligned coordinates with a code that works within these locally Cartesian coordinates? So that's about the geometrical complexities, but there's also, of course, a difference in physics between the edge and the core region. So the core region here is usually pretty hot, so that's why you often need a five-dimensional gyrokinetic description in phase space in order to model the plasma accurately. What simplifies is a bit that your fluctuation level in the core is usually pretty small, and therefore you can partially linearize your system. And as I said, in the core region, you can make use of these field-aligned coordinates or field-aligned grids. As you go into the edge region, due to the lower temperatures, fluid descriptions is or might be justified here. On the other hand, what makes it so that you go from a five-dimensional description to only three-dimensional description now. On the other hand, what makes it a bit more complicated is that you usually have a very high fluctuation levels, so your equations are highly nonlinear. And as I said before, you are not using the flux-aligned coordinates or grids anymore, but you will rely on these Cartesian grids here for the edge region. And now the idea is, can we couple such two codes with each other? So ideally, one representative here for a core code is the gyrokinetic code G. And a representative for the edge code is the so-called code Grillex, which is developed by my group. And the idea would be to use here precise in order to couple these two codes together. And probably you will use a bidirectional coupling, of course, which relies on an explicit coupling strategy. And as I said before, of course, now we have to deal with the geometric complexity of the codes, because the core code works in these flux-aligned coordinates, whereas the edge code works in these Cartesian coordinates here. And this has been our work that has been done by Ishan Desai during his master's thesis. He tried to couple two representatives of these codes together. And he communicated from a core code, he communicated values to the edge code, where he interpolated the values from the polar code, polar grid here in red, to the edge grid here in blue via radial basis function interpolation. And on the way back, he communicated the fluxes from the edge participant to the core participant via a nearest neighbor mapping. And a very simple example for such a coupling you can see here, where you have in the outer region, now in a circular cross section, you have the Cartesian grid here, And inside the black line, which is the interface, you have the polar coordinate system. And when, as a simple representative, we ran a simple diffusion model on a Gaussian blob here. And you can see that the blob nicely spreads across the interface, and you get also a smooth structure here, which tells us that this whole approach seems to work somehow. And of course, we also did some more careful convergence checks of our developed methods here. Finally, let me also point out to another approach that's not related with precise here, where the people tried to couple two gyrokinetic cores with each other. So again, gene for the core, but now XGC1, a gyrokinetic edge code, together. And they achieved already quite a bit. So for instance, here you can see a simulation performed with XGC1 in the outer region, gene in the center, and again XGC1 in the inner region. And they also performed simulations where they compared the monolithic versions of the codes versus a coupled version of the code, and they achieved a quite good agreement among these things. Since all these codes are rather expensive to run and often take millions of CPU hours by themselves, it's also important that the coupling is already designed from the beginning for exascale architectures. And what they use for their coupling is a framework called ADIOS, where for more details I have to refer, for instance, to this publication here. So let me now summarize my talk. So I've given you an introduction to magnetic fusion and the multi-physics problems that we're encountering here. For instance, I've shown you the interaction of the plasma with the neutral gas and the impurities, which is mostly solved via a straightforward volume coupling techniques. On the other hand, we also have multi-scale problems in our tokamaks, where we currently still rely on a model hierarchy. And the goal here is, of course, to make a full device high fidelity modeling. And one approach was to couple, for instance, a kinetic five-dimensional gyrokinetic code with a three-dimensional fluid code like relics. At the same time, it's always important that your codes and your coupling techniques remains quite performant in the end, especially when you want to go for the full gyrokinetic coupling. You have to go for exascale capability. Finally, due to the geometrical complexities related with the coordinate singularity at the separatrix, the edge and the core codes work in a different coordinate representation, where we pursued an interface coupling to couple both codes together, and we mapped between these different non-conformal conformal grids. At the moment, we achieved only a first-order convergence, mostly due to technicalities within the codes itself, and we want to pursue this thing further and go achieve a higher-order coupling also for more complex geometries now between the polar coordinate system and the Cartesian coordinate system. Finally, the next step will then be to couple to address the dimensionality of the codes, because we have to couple a five-dimensional code with a three-dimensional code, and we also have to address this issue. So how do we deal with the problem of information deficiency or information that we have too much actually in our system? Okay, thank you for your attention.